absolutely to work out, get the...
Good afternoon, members and friends of the White House Historical Association. This is the fourth element of our White House Historical Association inaugural series, and it's my pleasure and privilege to welcome you to be with us this afternoon. I'm Stuart McLaurin, president of the White House Historical Association, and it's my honor to introduce our two panelists. They'll be joining us shortly. They are the Honorable John F.W. Rogers, who is Vice Chairman of the Board of the White House Historical Association, and the Honorable Chris Liu, the Teresa A. Sullivan Practitioner, Senior Fellow at the Miller Center for Public Affairs at the University of Virginia. Both John and Chris have significant experience in presidential transitions and presidential inaugurations, which make them the ideal guests for our program this afternoon. They've participated in the conceptualization, coordination, planning, and execution of both presidential transitions and inaugurations. I'd like to remind you before we begin to consider your own questions you'd like to pose to them after I finish my conversation. And you can do that by entering those questions at the Q&A tab at the bottom of your screen. And please remember to indicate where you're watching from today. Well, our first guest is a very good friend of mine and significant leader in the White House Historical Association world. In fact, he's considered one of my bosses, being the vice chairman of our board of directors. He also served as the general manager of the Ronald Reagan Presidential Inauguration Committee in 1985 and as director of the presidential transition in 1981. He currently serves as executive vice president at Goldman Sachs, and he's chairman of the Goldman Sachs Foundation. He served in several senior positions in federal government, including Undersecretary of Management at the United States Department of State, the Assistant Secretary of the Treasury, and Assistant to the President of the White House. He currently serves as the Chairman of the Board of the Atlantic Council, Vice Chairman and Treasurer of our association, as I mentioned, Vice Chair of the Board of the American Academy in Rome. He is a life trustee and Treasurer of the Ronald Reagan Presidential Foundation, Chairman of the National Museum of American History. And our other guest is Chris Liu. As I mentioned, Chris is the Teresa Sullivan Practitioner Senior Fellow at the Miller Center at UVA. He also served in several senior positions in government as the Deputy Secretary of Labor, as the White House Cabinet Secretary, a very important position, and assistant to the President. He co-chaired the White House Initiative on Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders. Prior to the White House, he worked for then Senator Barack Obama as the legislative director and acting chief of staff. He was also executive director of the Obama-Biden transition in 2008 and 2009. And he's the author of a very topical book for recent times, co-editor of the book Triumphs and Tragedies of the Modern Congress, published in 2014. So if everyone is with us, we will dive in and talk about a very timely topic. Unless you've been hiding under a rock these days, you know that we're in the middle of a presidential transition and inauguration that will take place at noon tomorrow. And I'd like to begin by asking our two panelists, when they were undertaking these roles and they were approached to become involved with a presidential transition and a presidential inaugural, how did that come to be? How were you singled out to be responsible, to have some significant amount of responsibility? John, let's begin with you.
Yeah, thanks, Stuart. And let me just begin by saying hello to Chris. I don't know if I'm seeing you, Chris, down in Virginia, but hope you're well. You know, it's a very interesting thing. First of all, it seems so many years ago when this took place. But as right after the President Reagan had been elected, there had been something occurred which wasn't predicted to happen, which was he appointed James Baker to be the chief of staff. Ed Meese was expected to become the chief of staff. That didn't happen, but Ed was put in charge of the overall transition effort, and Jim Baker was put in charge of the White House transition. So I came together because I knew him from when he managed the President Ford campaign effort. I worked in the Ford White House at that time, and I knew the White House. I knew the White House structure, I guess, better than anybody else who was there at the moment. And so I was drafted into this effort. Jim Baker stayed away from Washington for the majority of the time, left it Ed Meese to run the transition. But we had a small team that worked towards the planning. And it was just by chance that I guess I knew the structure and knew where, knew the offices, that I would be put in charge of the planning for the White House piece of it.
And how about this?
I'm sorry, I didn't hear your question, Stuart.
Chris, I was going to ask Chris the same question. How did this come to drop in your lap?
Well, in April of 2008, I was then Senator Obama's legislative director. He was off on the campaign trail trying to win. He was in the middle of a heated primary contest against Hillary Clinton. But he had the foresight to realize that this was going to be the first post 9/11 transition. And since I had been with him from his first day in the Senate, I actually am a law school classmate of Barack Obama's. You know, he said, hey, can you start looking into this? How does one plan a presidential transition? And so I was the first person because I was the person that was around. You know, it's a funny thing, planning presidential transitions. It's kind of a small universe of people that have done it. Back then, I went to talk to the person who had run John Kerry's transition in 2004 and Al Gore's transition in 2000. But of course, none of them had the chance to implement their transition. So there's sort of a difference between planning and actually getting to execute it. So it was an honor to take it on. And, you know, several months after I began, John Podesta came on as the chairman of the effort. John, as all of you know, was the White House chief of staff under President Clinton. No one knows government better than John. And we kind of cobbled together, you know, about 100 people working on this effort before election day. And it's this funny thing, because you could do all the best work in the world planning a transition before election day, but if your candidate doesn't win, you never get to carry it out. Fortunately, we did get to carry it out. That 100 people who were the volunteers then ballooned into about 1,000 paid staff as well as volunteers. And then we were off and running for 77 days before inauguration day.
Well, you both worked for presidents that were two-term presidents. So you began with a transition and an inauguration, and then you had a second inaugural. Tell us the difference in those two occasions between the first time and the second time. Chris?
Yeah, you know, a second-term transition is kind of an awkward thing, because you certainly hope you don't have to have to do it, because you want to ensure that you're winning. But just going backwards a little bit, you know, we in 2009, when President Obama came into office, he was very publicly effusive about the cooperation that he had received from the outgoing Bush 43 administration. And he pledged that when he left office, whether it was in 4 years or 8 years, he would provide that same level of cooperation to his successor. So yes, we were both planning on trying to figure out how we can win re-election, but also fully understood that if we did not win, we would have to turn over. And so that was a kind of an odd experience. But again, it's the same types of things. You're asking all the White House offices, all the agencies to prepare materials for the incoming folks. You're kind of thinking about briefings you want to do. You're thinking about continuity of operations. But we, you know, did not have to carry that out until 4 years later.
How about, John, your perspective on the first versus the second?
Well, you know, for Ronald Reagan, both of them turned out to be very historical moments. First of all, in terms of the weather, still, I think to this day, Ronald Reagan's two inaugurals were the on the record for weather. The warmest in 1981 at 55 degrees, as I recall, and then also in 1985, it was minus 7 degrees, and I think it was a wind chill of minus 25. And so we canceled the parade and took the inauguration inside. In both of those cases, he was the first president that was inaugurated on the west front of the Capitol in 1981. That was basically done more as a cost savings by the Congress, the Congressional Inaugural Committee, than anything else, because they didn't have to build basically a large amphitheater because they took advantage of the terraces that existed at the time. Same way in 1985, it also had the advantage that it was the fifth time that a president was inaugurated actually on a Sunday. So we had two ceremonies. And I think, Chris, this also happened with President Obama on the second time that he had this historical thing of happening on a Sunday. I think it was a total of seven times that the inauguration day appeared, but some previous presidents refused to be inaugurated on that Sunday. Zachary Taylor, because he's a very religious man, wouldn't do it on a Sunday. So we had two different weather extremes between those two. We had it in two different locations because the second one had to be taken inside to the rotunda. So they were too historical in terms of that. So each one was a whole new experience that we hadn't planned for. And the second one, I was the general manager of the inaugural. And so all the effort that went into planning for it was thrown asunder and, overnight, basically, when we went to the president and said, listen, the instruments are freezing up. The kids are going to, be in really bad shape. We have to take it inside and we got to cancel the parade. And then later we went out to the, I think it was the one of the arenas and had an indoor celebration later for all the kids who had come to town with their bands.
Well, John, you mentioned the Congressional Inaugural Committee, and that brings to mind the number of players that are involved in coordinating this huge effort in Washington, D.C. And so your candidate is elected in November and is inaugurated in January. And that's a very short window of time to get things done in Washington with the Inaugural Committee, the Presidential Inaugural Committee, the Congress, the Military of District of Washington, the Military District of Washington, General Services Administration, the City of Washington. How do you integrate and coordinate all of those moving parts?
Well, you have, first of all, the Congressional Inaugural Committee, where the actual ceremony is taking place. That joint committee of both the House and Senate and their leadership, they're in charge of that ceremony. So you basically have to work with them to adjust any part of the program for the president, because it's their program. And it's basically their audience, their members who are principally there to bestow the power as the oath is administered and them to witness it. So you have to work very carefully with them. I remember in the second inaugural, I worked with John Chambers, who was Mac Mathias was the chair of the joint committee. By the way, John Chambers, that's Whitaker Chambers' son. So it was quite a historic moment to be working with him. And so we had a lot of going back and forth in terms of trying to achieve what we wanted to. But you're right. We had to work with a number of players. I remember that we wanted to have a jet flyover, and the Secret Service strongly objected to it. And needless to say, and Chris, I don't know if this ever came up with you, but needless to say, they had, in the end, they always get their way. We didn't have any flyover like that.
How about, Chris, the coordination efforts that you had to undertake and deal with?
Yeah, inaugurations, as John just said, there's the standard procedure, which is what happens around the Capitol that's planned by the Joint Committee. And that's pretty much, set from the ceremony to the seating to the congressional lunch. There's so much other things that actually can be adapted, again, whether it's the parade, whether it's the events that lead into Inauguration Day, whether it's the number of balls that you have. We had a much more toned down second term inauguration than the first term. The first term had lots of entertainers. We had a big concert on the Lincoln Memorial. We did an event the night before as a tribute to Senator McCain. I can't remember how many balls we had on inaugural night. There were a lot. But again, all of that also costs money as well. And, you know, and that's a fundraising apparatus that needs to be stood up, you know, and it's hard because there's a little bit of donor fatigue after you've gone through an expensive presidential campaign. We also had to raise money in the first inauguration for a transition. The government does give you some amount of money, but it doesn't cover all your costs. So there's lots of kind of competing concerns. You know, I know we're going to talk a little bit about the current inauguration, but a lot of it is, you know, what is the mood of the nation at the time? And so there's the coordination, there's money, and there's just frankly also the mood of the country.
Well, you talk about coordination with these government agencies and those who are involved even before your candidate is elected to office in November. But then comes the matters of protocol and dealing with those who are official and have to be accommodated. And then the personal friends and family members and those that are close to the president-elect. How do you balance all of those relationships in terms of seating and tickets and making and keeping everybody happy? John, thoughts on that?
Well, it's, Chris, have you experienced it? It's very difficult. And the one thing I learned about presidential inaugurals is to stay away from women's fur coats at the ball, because invariably somebody's coat is going to get turned up missing. So I don't have fond memories of the aspects of that. But the seating becomes a back and forth between trying to get the people the president wants to make sure that are there, which are usually his family and his friends, and the other competing interests that you have, particularly when you have, you know, a new staff that's joining him. And as you can imagine, as large as our government is, there's lots of people who think that they have to absolutely be there as witnesses to it. So it's a lot of give and take.
You know, when I the first Obama inauguration, I had been the executive director of the transition, and then I had been I'd been appointed as the White House cabinet secretary, so in charge of the cabinet starting on day one of the administration. And I remember sitting in the transition office a couple weeks before inauguration day, and the inaugural people dropped off like boxes full of inauguration tickets, and they were all color coded. And I was supposed to figure out how to distribute all of these tickets to the incoming cabinet, the incoming agency staff, all of their friends and family. And I was just basically given these seating charts. Okay, orange goes here, blue goes here, red goes here. And you had to figure out how to divide this up. And it was the nuttiest experience. And you all may remember there was this infamous thing in 2009 called the purple tunnel of doom. Like the people who had the purple seats were routed by the police into the Third Street tunnel on I-395, and they couldn't get out of the tunnel, and they were just stuck in this tunnel for most of the swearing in ceremony. So these are still things that we all laugh about and kind of dread happening. But yeah, I mean, it's donors that need to be taken care of. It's members of Congress get their own seats, but it's also other dignitaries, governors, mayors, cabinet. You know, and there's a protocol to all of this. And so it's a good skill to learn both from the protocol and the logistics standpoint, because it serves you well later on all through government to get this right.
Security is always a significant concern. John mentioned the coordination of the Secret Service and their concern about a flyover. But look at what's happening now and what your successors are dealing with in preparations for tomorrow. Can you relate to that? And are there any insights and stories that you can talk about that will help people understand the complexity of security arrangements for an event like this? John, thoughts?
Well, you know, listen, the inaugurations I was involved in were a different period of time in our country's history. It's obvious that on a progressive basis, the security concerns have gotten more and more complex and perhaps necessary. But I always fear that as we go through this process, we continue to actually push the people further away from their government and their leaders. And some of the steps that we go through of where the trip from the Capitol to the White House and both ways actually,
you know, the complexity now that's associated with that movement is really quite amazing. And I've thought a lot about whether or not there's other ways to do this that, you know, don't require so much of this kind of security, that would, you know, be able to have the opportunity for people to see the process and share in it, and participate in it. And Chris mentioned the balls, and I think the balls or parties become more of a way to have activity because it's really sort of after the effect of the day, and depending if the, you know, the president makes their trips around to the different balls, it's, you know, it's short order. The security is, you know, somewhat limited comparatively speaking, or at least after the president leaves. But we've made it much more complicated, and, you know, in this world. And I think Chris mentioned earlier about 9/11, and I'm sure that all our considerations from that point on, it's just been a different layer of security than we did previous to that.
Yeah, you know, I'll add, as again, as I said, the 2008-2009 transition was the first post 9/11 transition, and the potential security risks at the inauguration were something that we were keenly aware of. I, at the time, I was not aware of this, but there's been subsequent reporting that there was a credible threat against against the inauguration about something that would potentially happen at the swearing in. And so it has since been reported that that required extensive cooperation between the outgoing Secretary of State, between Condoleezza Rice and the incoming Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton. And there was kind of a managing of that. And it's one of the historical reasons, the anomalies as to why all but two outgoing Bush cabinet members resigned before Inauguration Day, January 20th, 2009. One was Bob Gates, who stayed on to serve as Secretary of Defense under President Obama. The other one was Mike Chertoff, the Homeland Security Secretary. He was asked to stay on for one extra day in case something happened. And so fortunately, nothing happened. But that does speak to the importance of the outgoing and the incoming administrations being hand in glove in terms of their cooperation. And it's something that, you know, frankly, is concerning to me about what has happened over this transition, that that level of collaboration hasn't happened, because this is not a partisan thing. This is wanting to ensure that this handover of power, which is really unique in the world, happens as seamlessly as possible.
And to that point, Chris, I think people may not realize that at noon on Inauguration Day, all the White House badge holders from the previous administration, their badges are deactivated and the new ones are activated. And so it just becomes an immediate handoff. How do you really functionally bridge from the old into the new? To the new White House staff, are they waiting at the gate at 12 o'clock to go in and begin their jobs?
Yeah, you know, I mean, look, this is an oddity in the political dynamics around the world. I mean, just think about this. Every 4 or 8 years, 4,000 some political appointees, more or less, leave their jobs, and then several hundred new ones come in throughout the entire government. And that takeover is happening regarding the U.S. government, which is, you know, the largest, most powerful entity in the world. You would not run any company that way. You wouldn't run any nonprofit that way. We're on at one time, everyone leaves. And the fact that we pull this off every 4 or 8 years is both a testament to this idea of a peaceful transfer of power, but it's also a testament to the great career officials that keep all of the trains running while this is happening. What makes that transfer more difficult in the White House is, by and large, the White House staff is all political staff. So there's no one that stays over. So I remember walking into the West Wing probably around 2 p.m. on Inauguration Day 2009. It was empty. I mean, like, all of the jumbo photos been taken off the walls. You know, the offices were being cleaned. They had computers, they had chairs, but there was really, like, there was no papers there. I mean, everything kind of walks out with the outgoing administration. So again, speaks to the importance of really planning in advance. because there's not a lot of career staff in the White House who can help you with that. And so you have to sort of get your White House staff appointed early, make sure they understand what their roles are, and start to create those processes to make decisions, because there's no lag time before you have to hit the ground running.
Mm-hmm. Same with you, John, in the Reagan administration.
Yeah, you know, it's very similar. You know, at the time, and I don't really know to the degree the staffing at the White House today, but there were people who are career, certainly the residents, 90 some people that are there and continue on. And then there were at that time operating units that worked in the mail room, that worked in the records office, that worked in the travel office, that worked in a series of different places that had a, they served at the pleasure of any president, but they had been there for years. So you have to rely on the continuity of a lot of these people to do it. You know, when the 20th Amendment was approved in 33 and we collapsed the transition period from March till January, it becomes even more critical of what Chris is speaking about. You have to be able to immediately start that transition. And I think, you know, the history books will prove out those presidents that had the best transitions. And that is, to Chris's point, the furtherance of our continuity and in our government. So it's always in the interest to do this and to do it as well as we can and accommodate the incoming administration as much as possible. The president may be president until 12 noon, but it's a matter of our own national security and proper governance that happens as smoothly as we can make it.
I have one more question before we turn to some questions that we've received from our audience. And you both work for the president-elect of the United States or the president of the United States, but President Obama and President Reagan had very strong first ladies. Is there a story behind the scenes about working with Mrs. Obama or Mrs. Reagan in anticipation of the inauguration, and how involved were they in that planning? Chris?
So I didn't have as much dealings with Mrs. Obama, but you know what was notable is having young children in the White House again. And I know that, just a couple of small things. We, you know, there was a kind of jungle gym swing set that was put on the South Lawn for the girls. I know that Mrs. Obama really appreciated the courtesies from Mrs. Bush, as well as the Bush girls, and helping that transition, but it's just a whole different dynamic. It requires, you know, scoping out schools, making sure that the security for the girls is robust, but also non-obtrusive. It is trying to ensure that when you're scheduling for the president, you're mindful of the fact that, you know, this was a president who wanted, President Obama wanted to have breakfast with his kids in the morning and have dinner with them in the evening. He would continue working well after that, but also understanding, you know, how many evening functions you could do, what was available on weekend time. So while I did not deal with Mrs. Obama on a lot of those things, the family priorities were really kind of central in a lot of the decisions that we made around the White House.
And John, was Mrs. Reagan central to the decisions made around the White House?
Well, she was very involved in the decisions, I think, about who would be the chief of staff and who would be best positioned. So there was back and forth, definitely. And she was quite a guardian of her husband. It was a very hard-fought campaign. But Mrs. Carter was very gracious about setting up the time to do it. Interestingly enough, because the President Carter had a view about the energy level, the White House was, you know, basically heated at about 65 degrees. So the tour was cut short pretty quickly because it was just too cold for Nancy to see the two floors. And so they had their meeting. But they, you know, stayed in touch. They were part of this ongoing union of first ladies. And Rosalind Carter was there at the funeral of Nancy Reagan in California and came all that way. So these traditions are extraordinarily important.
And do you think not having those take place, the meeting between President Trump and President-elect Biden and Mrs. Trump and Dr. Biden, is that more symbolic or is there real substance and importance that, that will be missing because those meetings did not take place?
Yes, I think it's very important. They give the sense, it's all a matter of an assurance about who we are as Americans and how we come together to advance the interest of America. And these, you know, our country's made up of symbols and rituals. That's why the desecration that occurred at the Capitol is so disturbing, because it was an attack on both of those things, the symbolism of the Capitol and the ritual that was going on at that time. These things are also part of that, and we're robbed of that. So I find it to be very unfortunate.
You know, I could not agree with John more. I mean, look, Dr. Biden does not need to be shown the second floor residence of the White House. She's been there multiple times when the Obamas were there. But it's the symbolism. It's the symbolism of bitter rivals coming together for the good of the nation. And it's important to understand, we have done presidential transitions for 200 plus years during war, during depression, even after bitterly fought presidential campaigns. So it's symbolic, but I don't minimize the symbolism. The symbolism is what makes our country great and shows that our democracy is bigger than either the two people who competed for the office.
Questions from our audience, our members who are watching today. Brandon from Durham, North Carolina, asked for an explanation of the transfer of the military apparatus, specifically the nuclear codes, but how does the entire military shift on a dime from one commander-in-chief to the other commander-in-chief? Chris, any thoughts on that?
It's complicated. Let's just say this. I mean, I'm not the expert on this. My understanding is that there's not just one nuclear football. It's a series of, you know, codes, instructions, and you know, it will be with President Trump until 12 p.m. and then it will move. Perhaps will be deactivated or taken away from him. Another set will be given to President Biden at 12 p.m. But it is complicated because, as we've talked about, all of this, even leaving aside what's happening right now in Washington, D.C., even in the best of circumstances, there's big security considerations. There's not only this taxes the Secret Service, which has to defend and protect both the president and the president-elect, their military assets with, you know, traditionally when the outgoing president leaves, they fly on what is Air Force One until he is no longer the president, but still a military plane with military personnel, and he'll be greeted on the other end by military personnel. And then you have military personnel that will be staffing the incoming president. So it taxes a lot of resources, but again, we have done this every 4 or 8 years, so we know how to do it.
John, any thoughts on the military transition?
Yeah, I think Chris covered it quite succinctly. I think they're quite prepared to know exactly what to do. Now, remember that, you know, when presidents die and their funerals are held, it's a military funeral because it's an honor of him being commander-in-chief. The courtesy that it's extended in most cases by the new president to the outgoing president, and then the military's honors as they depart, no longer, as Chris says, Air Force One, no longer the commander-in-chief, but nonetheless giving them the due respect that they receive. It's always been the case. In this particular case, as I understand it, and I'm not close to it, but as I understand it, there'll just be a transfer that happens. He'll be, he'll be commander-in-chief until he's not, wherever he is, if that's Florida. And then that military aid with the football, as they call it, will end that duty, as Chris said, and then there'll be another one who's at the Capitol with the new president.
Next question, Sally from Des Moines says, with all the stress and responsibility that you have to execute these events and pull them off, do you actually get to enjoy them and feel the meaning of them? And do you have any special memories of your own from those times? John?
Yeah, sure, because, you know, you interact with people. I think my favorite memory in 1985 was with Frank Sinatra, We got to sing, you know, just a group in my office saying happy birthday to him because it was his birthday and it just in advance of the inauguration. And as he said to me, I should keep my day job. So that was a fun moment. So sure, there's an interacting with the team to get something done, or then when you witness it and you see it happening, yeah, you can take a lot of pride in that.
Chris, any special memories?
Yeah, I mean, it was a whirlwind. And I remember because there were a couple of black tie events around the inauguration, and I was still running the transition. So I think I kept my tuxedo in my transition office. You know, I'd work from dawn to dusk, put a tuxedo on, call my wife and say, hey, I'll meet you at the at X, you know, museum or wherever the event was held, and we'll meet on the, you know, in the front door. It was hectic. It was tiring. We had, particularly that first inauguration, there was a lot more sort of star-studded events that were just kind of a lot of fun, but you were just kind of running on fumes. And I think for me, just the biggest like moment that it kind of hit me was, as I said, inauguration day. I was at the inauguration, and then they took us, we didn't go to the congressional lunch. We weren't invited, the senior White House staff, but they basically loaded us on a bus that had been parked by the Supreme Court. While all the dignitaries are having lunch, they drove us down Pennsylvania Avenue along the parade route that hadn't started yet, drove us into West Exec, dropped us off between the White House, EEOB, checked us in, and then basically showed us to our offices. And so I was, as I said, I was sitting in my office in the West Wing about 2 hours or hour and a half after the president had been inaugurated. Like, that was, for me, the fun part, and getting a chance to kind of just wander around the West Wing on day one. And, you know, the jumbo photos aren't up. The Secret Service were very lenient. They're like, oh, sure, go into the Oval Office, walk around, because tomorrow you won't be able to do this. I mean, that to me was fun, because literally the next day, it was a much different White House. Security was everywhere. It was very buttoned up. And we were kind of, you know, going to work. But for that first day, sort of just being able to wander around the West Wing was a once in a lifetime experience.
Well, I'd love to ask this question of actual presidents, but since we don't have those with us today, I'll ask it of you. I want to know what's their feeling when they come into the White House for the first time as president of the United States. And what about you when you come in the first time in your roles? Do you feel a sense of continuity of history, that you're part of something larger than your role, or is it just the immediate pressure of the moment to get down to work? John, what was your feeling?
Well, in 1981, when the inauguration was taking place and the ceremony was happening, that I was watching basically on a television. Now, remember, this is 1981, so there's no cell phones except for a gigantic brick that I had. There was no, you know, computer systems of any kind, really, in the White House. So when the stroke, you know, 12 happened, it was just a motorcade that was coming from the transition office into the White House, where we just brought everything in. And we brought in everything, including all the files, the background files that had already started on all the people who were going to be joining the White House. And we had to get the security apparatus done. But you go into the Oval Office, and as Chris said, I was there by myself and I was in charge. And by the way, you make decisions, and Chris, you probably saw this, you make decisions and then they sort of stick. I mean, wherever the allocation of offices by function, you're telling everybody where they're going, where they're gonna be, it's all laid out. And then you end up living that course for the next few years. And I've thought about this, Stuart, in relationship to the East Wing, because you know, this is why you have to really think about from administration to administration. You know, I made the decision that we were going to put people, the legislative affairs people, back into the East Wing, that President Carter had moved out of the East Wing. That stuck for the whole 8 years. It never was repeated. So in all these things that happen, you know, stick with you. So I'm hoping that President Obama thinks about this. President Biden thinks about this plan about what to do with the East Wing before just jumping in and changing your mind, because you live with it. You just live with the outcomes.
Yeah.
For a long time.
Yeah, I will tell you, I mean, certainly the weight of the job was very apparent to me when I walked into the West Wing. I am the child of immigrants. My parents came here to the country in the late 50s, early 60s. And so in one generation, for my family being, you know, students here, trying to assimilate into a new country, to have their son worked in the West Wing, you know, the weight of that, the import of that was very apparent to me when I walked in. It is sort of funny seeing the incoming, the new president, the new vice president, because, you know, they're clearly awed by the experience. They're still trying to get their feet wet. They're still trying to learn process. I probably did one of the first briefings of Vice President Biden as vice president the day after Inauguration Day, so January 21st. We were swearing in new members of the cabinet. And I think John, others may know this, the president can't swear in people, the vice president can. So I was asked to come to the vice president's office, tell him what he needed to do. And mind you, I had never presided over a swearing in ceremony. I barely knew what the oath of office, and I actually had to Google it. I printed it out. I double and triple checked it with the like clerk's office to make sure I got the right oath of office, because God forbid the vice president would improperly swear somebody in. But, you know, I very calmly said, Mr. Vice President, here's the run of show. Here's what you do. He's taking it all in. Neither of us are sort of, neither of us will admit this is, we have no idea what we're doing. We're kind of making this up as we go along. But with each one of these moments, you kind of, you know, grow into the role a little bit more. And you know, after a week, it's just like you've always worked there before, but it is, it's hard not to be awestruck when you work in the White House.
Last question from an audience member, one of our members, is from William in Fort Wayne, and he asked about the British transitions when they go from prime minister to prime minister, and it's such a short period and there's not a lot of ceremony. Why is ours so different? But I think perhaps with a monarch, the next coronation, there will be a big ceremony. So I guess my question following from William is, what makes this inauguration of our president of the United States so important to us? What does it say to the world about American freedom and democracy and our systems and about our election and peaceful transition of power? Chris?
Yeah, I mean, I know a little bit about the British system. I mean, there are a couple of things that distinguish it. One, it's the parliamentary system. And my understanding is that most of the agents, most of the people that work in the British ministries are career civil servants. There's only a very small number of people at the top that actually change over in a change administration. Plus, because of the parliamentary system, you kind of have this shadow government, the shadow cabinet of people who are ready to take over. But it does, there is a larger question as to why the transition is as long as it is. And this January 20th date is a relatively, not recent, but it's, you know, 80 some years. It used to be in March and now it's in January 20th. You know, one could make the argument that given modern technology, it should be even shortened. But I do think more broadly, and as, you know, John so eloquently said, it's a symbol. This transfer of power is a symbol, and we could minimize it and simply say it's a symbol, but really our country, it's a symbol of our democracy. And it shows kind of the stability of our government, that it doesn't matter which party controls, it doesn't matter how bitterly fought the campaign is, we all come together for our democracy. And that's why this symbol matters. And it's why, you know, presidents who have fought bitterly during a campaign come together, they go through these rituals of having coffee, of riding together, of being there. It's one of the reasons why all, you know, the former presidents who are physically able to travel show up. It's why the outgoing cabinet shows up and incoming cabinet shows up. Members of Congress on both sides come. This is our U.S. government. And this is an important symbol. And that's why these traditions matter.
John, we'll give you the last word.
You know, listen, in the British system, it's a monarch. All ceremonies are tied from the monarch. The government speaks in the form of the monarch. We don't have a monarchy. We have a president. they served for very short periods of time, two terms. By any standard in governing, that's a pretty short period of time, but it gives a degree of transparency to our government. I would fear the day, which I have to say right now, I think we're at that moment, that we end up adopting a sort of parliamentary type government to where one administration changes, the next one comes in, and there's just a wholesale removal of everything and a transfer of everything. It is in the continuity of our government that holds the things that I think are most sacred to Americans. And I, for one, believe, you know, the ability for Americans to come together and work together, particularly across party lines, is paramount to this democracy. And we will only hold together if we hold these special things. You know, this is not the first time a president didn't show up to its newly elected presidents, but that hasn't happened in modern time for a long time, not since John Adams and John Quincy Adams. This is what we need to do, and particularly at this time, we need this kind of thing. And I am so happy the former presidents are coming who can travel to this inauguration. I'm happy that they will be participants in this because they carry with them those traditions. And while we're not meeting what should be met by the outgoing president, nonetheless, we will have that with those former presidents there. The continuity will be spoken for.
Well, John Rogers and Chris Liu, I want to thank you on behalf of the association and those viewing today for your significant contributions to leadership in the White House, for the presidents with whom you worked, and also in your ongoing work to share these stories. You both are a significant part of White House history. And it's our honor as an association, John, as you know, being our vice chair, that our role and responsibilities are exactly the same from president to president. We were founded by First Lady Jacqueline Kennedy 60 years ago to be the private partner to the White House. And it's our privilege to do so. And we've already begun working with Dr. Biden and her team. And we look forward to the next 4 years of doing the exact same thing that we've done for the past 60 on behalf of the American people. As Mrs. Kennedy famously said, the White House belongs to the American people. I'd like to thank our members and guests who have watched us this program today. It's your generosity and support that make these programs and all of our work possible. If you're not yet a member of the association, would like to become more involved, please reach out through our website, whitehousehistory.org, or give us a call at the association, and myself or one of our colleagues would be happy to speak with you. Have a good evening. Enjoy watching the inauguration tomorrow. And here's wishing you all a safe and healthy and happy new year. Thank you, John. Thank you, Chris, very much.
Thank you, and best to you, Chris. Thank you.